Thank you, Justin, for the warm introduction. We have truly inspiring and engaging panelists waiting to share their views today. Let me introduce them. Padmavati Srinivasan, our first panelist for the day. Padmavati Srinivasan was affected by polio when she is 3 months old and lost her mobility below neck. Despite of her socio-economic and physical challenges, she has completed her chartered accountancy, cost accountancy, and had a master's degree in psychology. She started her career practicing and worked at Standard Chartered Bank, and currently she is working in Barclays Shared Services as Vice President for Transfer Pricing. She volunteers at various organizations, including one for preventing suicide, as she is a trained psychologist. We will hear more when she speaks. A warm welcome, Padmavati. Pradhana Pratik Kaul. Mrs. Pradhana Pratik Kaul is co-founder of Giftabled. Pradhana worked with IBM and iVolunteer. She is a cost marketer, motivational speaker, and consultant for diversity and inclusion. Her contributions to the industry has won various awards and accolades, including Social Entrepreneur of the Year by Nama Bengaluru Foundation, Best Social Entrepreneur by Hand in Hand, Top 3 Social Entrepreneurs by IIM Kolkata Innovation Park. Great to have you here, Prarthana. Welcome. Harish. Harish Hande is a social entrepreneur. He co-founded Selco India in 1995 after holding a PhD in energy engineering from the University of Massachusetts Lowell. Later, he became the CEO of Selco Foundation in 2014. Harish won various awards, including the Ashoka Fellow in 2008, Max Essay in 2011, and the trustees of University of Massachusetts had awarded him the Doctorate of Humane Letters in 2011. It's our privilege to have you here, Harish. A warm welcome to you. We will be taking a few questions at the end of this session, and please send them across to us. Our email address is indiainclusionsummit@gmail.com. So we will start our panel discussion. The first question I have is to Padmavati. Hi, Padma. One of the barriers for persons with physical challenges is infrastructure or office premises. With the new normal work from home, I believe there is no infrastructure barriers as we are working from home in our own space. Do you have any inputs or thoughts on this?
Thank you, Rakesh, and thank everyone for this opportunity. See, my thoughts on this would be, Rakesh, that yes, with the new normal and the world has become virtual, it has opened lots of doors for people like us, and definitely that's a very positive thing. But at the same time, working from home is causing quite a few of issues which I can share from my personal experience also. The first thing that I would like to say, the infrastructure setup that we have in office, like a proper chair and a proper table, which is like, you know, there are tables which come with height adjustable things, which is not possible to be installed at home. So, because of that, we are getting a physical discomforts which is causing a lot of problems. So that is one thing that is causing an issue. And the second thing is the long hours of work. Like, as everyone who are in the corporate world would agree, the line between work and home has become very thin, and that, you know, where work stops, where home starts is becoming a questionable thing these days. So because of that, you continue to sit for a long period of time. You don't take breaks, where in office you would just like to go for a coffee and then take a walk, you know, have conversations, etc. So those physical discomforts are definitely causing an issue. So which I think whether everyone can be can replicate an office environment at home is something that is a very questionable thing, because I know somebody, a few colleagues of mine who live in a very small house, who are not even able to put a proper chair and table in their home. So these are difficulties, something that maybe corporates can think about and come up with some kind of a solution to make even a work environment more user-friendly for people who are differently abled. And the second thing is on the mental thing, like, for mental in terms of work stress and not meeting people and talking to colleagues, sharing things is also kind of causing some kind of issues, because we are by nature, we are, humans are bound to, be more comfortable when we meet people, talk people, etc. And that is also kind of resulting in mental stress and all that. I know every corporate is taking a lot of steps in terms of mental well-being also, but how comfortable we are talking about it is something that we need to keep in mind. These are the constraints that I think is possible.
Thank you, Padma. That holistically covered different aspects of life and also uncovered the myth that timing is most important and where you cut off the work and where the home life starts. Thanks for that insightful information. Harish, now I have the question for you. After listening at Padmavati's conversation, is it the lack of awareness or the drawback of implementation that corporates are not able to provide a 360 degrees work from home or reasonable accommodations otherwise for people with disabilities? What do you think on that lines?
Thanks, Rakesh, and thanks, Padma, for putting that perspective in place. More so, Rakesh, I'll also challenge, I'll put another challenge. See, again, work from home is a luxury for men. What happens to the lot of blacksmith blowers or silk weavers or sewing machine or... And if you look at the 45% of the population that is poor, who do their livelihoods basic of physical labor, or you can't talk to a farmer and say we are going to work from home, or a street vendor can work from home, or a silk weaver or a person who is done working on sewing machine. There are a lot of people who are challenged today, who are brilliant, intellectually extremely brilliant. I mean, may not have the complete physical abilities that typical human beings have, but there are hardly any facilities for them, and it's been a disaster in many ways for that population. So I think we need to be more inclusive in our thought process in terms of our innovations. We should be inclusive in our way we look at the rest 40% of the population that is underserved in many ways, and I think we need to. The type of products or type of opportunities today, yes, the people who, if there is a education and the corporates who are doing it, that means you're going to always believe that such people can only work for them, and I create a certain facility in my office. How do I now inspire people to be innovators, to be entrepreneurs? Why can't they start their own corporates? Why can't they start innovating? Where are the opportunities that we are creating for them? I think that's where our push is towards, are we truly creating an ecosystem that is inclusive for any person to come and innovate, incubate, and start their own corporate? I think that's where we need to, a society that starts stopping. And I see in the rural and the semi-rural areas, the opportunities are much more dismal. And how can we change it? By thinking more inclusively. It's not about processes, but also how we change the thinking process to be a little more inclusive in that innovations to happen. And rather than romantically looking at, I'm going to help people, nobody wants any help. How do we create an ecosystem where people all help themselves? So removing that romantic that we are charity and all that, but thinking more inclusively is where the society needs to change. Right?
That's a wonderful way of putting, Harish. I really like the way you narrated the inclusive thought process is something which has to be inculcated in the organizations and the people who work in the organization. And yeah, as you said, the rural and the semi-rural areas and the underprivileged, 40% of the underprivileged is where you need to invest more and understand how we can enable them to be helping each other rather than relying on the help from the corporates or other organizations. Thank you so much for that insightful information. Pratna, let me come to you. Now we heard Padmavati and Harish talking about their perspectives. Do you think organizations like Giftable can come closer to bridge that gap which the organization and the people organizations are currently doing, and where people with disabilities will be able to use their fullest potential? I'm sure there is a gap that has to be filled in. Mm-hmm. Do you think the organizations like Giftable can bridge that?
Certainly, Rakesh, and that's a very valid question. In fact, I would say pandemic has taught us to think in different way. Especially, I remember when COVID lockdown started, we were among those first few organizations. We completely moved to virtual within 2 weeks' time. We didn't even wait. Like, you know, I was not sure how long will it take. But you won't believe, within last couple of months, we were able to have around 3,000 volunteers sign up from different corporates just to volunteer their time. You know, we could have a digital library set up where we now have thousands of stories that could be heard by visually impaired across the world. Not just that, I had like around 500 plus signups where people now can actually start communicating with deaf in sign language. I still remember almost 13 years back when I learned sign language and I used to meet any deaf, I used to be fully excited. And, you know, I used to go and say, hey, hi, my name is Prathana. And the immediate response I used to get was, are you deaf? And I was like, no. Is someone in your family deaf? And I was like, no, why? Because you're signing. So for them, it was like, if you're signing, you're not part of that community. Like, you know, you must be having some reason for learning sign language. And we wanted to change that notion when we started Giftable. And I still remember one day, one volunteer posting saying, hey, I learned alphabets in sign language. I see a pottery artist who is deaf in MG Road, Bangalore. And I just go and I said, let me try my name. And she goes and says, hi, my name is Alekya. And the response she got was, are you volunteer, Giftable? Now, Giftable is just one such organization. There's so many such organizations doing amazing work. And if corporates, like Harish rightly said, it's about ecosystem, right? Everyone coming together and bringing in that change. We need not be next to the beneficiary to bring in that change. I sitting here today, I'm working with acid attack victims who are in North India, or I'm working with artists with disability in Kashmir as well as in North Karnataka, right? In Maharashtra. So it is possible. Just that what we need to do is understand and quickly move to the virtual world. We were able to do trainings, vocational trainings with support of partner NGOs in rural areas. Like Harish said, right, you know, partners, farmers can't come and become virtual. There are a lot of 70% of our population is in rural area, and organized sector can at the most hire 1% of people with disability. What happens to the rest of population? Correct. So today we can proudly say, you know, last month we had this order from Cisco where they said, hey, we want to recognize 900 employees sitting in 900 different locations. Now imagine we getting in touch with courier partner and delivering those products made by people with disability to 900 different locations, supporting livelihood of so many people with disability, right? And that's the role
right.
Organizations like Giftable can surely play.
Awesome. And definitely that I agree, the chain system of working with the organizations, yes, and getting on to the most rural parts, and which is very much close to my heart. I being a person who hail from a rural part of Andhra Pradesh,
right,
definitely value the importance of bringing the upskill in the rural areas. Thank you very much, exactly, for that information, Prathana.
Thank you.
So let me now come to each one of you with a question, and I would like to get that answered in a sentence. And let me start with Harish. How can the organizations or our colleagues can make the workplace inclusive? What is one thing that comes to your mind?
Oh, the one thing that comes is thinking. I mean, if I'm talking to anybody, I'm going to fight with anybody or going to praise or work with absolutely no, doesn't matter what disabilities or what the last name on which religion and what caste. I think if we can break that barrier, and if that comes from the education system, and as if I'm, so that's where it's the thinking. For me, it's pure and simple is thinking. Everything else will follow. Awesome. And as long as we kill that thinking process.
What do you say, Padma? Is there a way you think organizations and our colleagues can make our workplace inclusive?
Sensitizing people is the one thing that comes to my mind, Rakesh. So, you know,
that's great. That's people aware of starting off. Yeah, that's the beginning for everything. Wonderful.
Yeah.
What do you say, Prathana?
I would say believe and become an advocate. We keep hearing like, you know, I want to be an ally. And I think that's the message, be an ally. Everything is possible. Like each one of us can do some little things and create that larger impact.
Thank you very much, all the panelists, for sharing your views. Before we go to the Q&A, I have one question for you, Padma. When you are applying for a job, what is the first thing that comes to your mind? I'm very much curious to know that.
The first thing that would come to my mind is the accessibility of the place where I'm going to attend the interview, Rakesh, because how I will reach and whether I'll be able to climb, get inside the building, whether the chair in which I'm going to sit and attend the interview is going to be comfortable. All those things are the first things that come to my mind. So because, again, this is from personal experience, I've faced many challenges. So that's the thing that comes
to my mind. That's very true. And I totally agree, because for many of us who don't know about or think about disability, all that we think of is, what is the question or what are the questions that the interviewer is going to ask me? Am I going to get this job or not? But for persons with disabilities, it is about the infrastructure. Am I able to properly go? Are they going to help me with the reasonable accommodations during the interview? Am I able to have a comfortable chair so that I can concentrate on the questions, etc.? And that's very much true. Thanks for your sharing your experience, Padma. We have come to the end of this session today. Thank you very much, Prarthana, Harish, and Padma, for sharing your views today. Thank you so much.